Today on Upfront, the U.S. Senate candidate who says the most important race for Republicans right now isn't his.
What future generations of Americans look like in this country could well be determined by the outcome of the Scott Walker race.
Democrats trying to win the right to challenge Governor Walker. Can they continue to play nice just 2 weeks out from the primary? It's been called the war on women. What's it really about?
I think that the left is really reaching for anything that they can grab onto.
I think it's going to encourage people to get out and vote for people who will support both genders.
It's all this week on Upfront.
Honest, candid, insightful. This is Upfront with Mike Gouchet.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to Upfront. Don't be surprised if you hear the phrase war on women a lot in Wisconsin in the next 7 weeks. Nationally, Democrats have been using the term to refer to Republican legislation and commentary they say is hostile to women. Republicans have pushed back hard, citing comments by Democrats they say have insulted stay-at-home moms, for example. Now the war on women theme has emerged in Wisconsin's historic recall election for governor. Democratic candidates Kathleen Faulk and Tom Barrett are slamming Governor Walker for signing a bill that repeals the state's Equal Pay Enforcement Act. Is there really a war on women, or is this just posturing to win women voters in the recall? We're asking two state representatives today, Republican Michelle Litjens of Vinland in Winnebago County and Democrat Sandy Pasch of Whitefish Bay in Milwaukee County. Thanks to both of you for being with us today. Sandy Pasch, since Democrats are pushing this as an issue, let me ask a very basic question. How much will this issue play into the outcome of the recall election?
I think it'll play a very major role in it, because this isn't just political posturing. This is real, what's been happening. Women make up a big part of the electorate, and they're a very independent swing vote. And when they see the attitudes, the attacks, the verbiage that is used to describe women by the other party, it's just pretty appalling, and I think it's going to encourage people to get out and vote for people who will support both genders and not just one gender.
Representative Litjens, is it political posturing, or is there something here? Is there a record here to be looked at?
Actually, it's pretty disappointing. You know, this is 2012. I kind of thought we were past this. I thought women were treated equally as men. And I'm really surprised that we're actually discussing this now. I think that the left is really reaching for anything that they can grab onto so they can guarantee themselves a win this fall. What we did actually has nothing to do with equal pay in the state of Wisconsin. And what we should be celebrating as women is that women actually earn more. Single childless women earn more money than single childless men. That's something to celebrate. And the fact that the left believes that women are that stupid, or that we're just not that engaged, that we would believe that a woman and a man can be hired for the same job on the same day, and a woman is going to be paid less money, that is absurd. And I think that it's going to backfire on them, because it's very demeaning that they're talking to women like that.
As a representative, it's not absurd. It's the fact. We just had Equal Pay Day. It was April 17th. And it's not a day that we celebrate, but it's a day that's marked as it takes women 4.5 months longer to reach the same pay level that it takes a man in 1 year. We get, in Wisconsin, women get paid 78 cents for every dollar a man earns. And that goes on throughout the lifetime. And when a woman retires, her Social Security is going to be lower because of that pay inequity that has been there. And what Wisconsin did in 2009 was passed a bill that said, you can't do that in our state. We have to give a voice to women and to minorities who are discriminated against in the workplace.
But don't women already have a voice? Couldn't they go to federal court? Can't they? There are other avenues for them to pursue discrimination.
We know that federal laws are not as effective, and this was a law that really had some teeth in it. Now, there haven't been a huge number of lawsuits. In fact, I don't know how many, if there have been any, but putting the strength behind that bill forced employers to say, wait, you know, there will be some teeth behind it. It won't just be a slap on the wrist if we decide to pay our women 78 cents to the dollar.
Representative, you co-sponsored the legislation that called for the repeal of the Equal Pay Enforcement Act. You said, you know, it hurt business, and I can understand why business would want to see this repeal, but why is this in the best interest of women?
Well, just to get back to one other thing, women do not, they're not paid less money because of their gender. Women are often paid less due to their lifestyle and the jobs that they choose to take due to their lifestyle choices. That is not because of your gender. So we have always had equal pay protection in Wisconsin and at the federal level. If a woman feels she's discriminated against for any employment reasons, a raise or whatnot, or a promotion, she has the right to file with the Department of Workforce Development, and they will pursue an investigation. And if they find that she was wronged, or if someone's discriminated against her for age or a disability or anything, they can file a claim and they will investigate that. And if that individual was wronged, they can guarantee their job back, and they can guarantee up to 2 years back pay or any fees that they've incurred in that process. They can also file, if they feel they really want to punish that employer, they can file for punitive damages at the federal level. None of that has changed. But what we did when we repealed the 2009 Act 20, was to, people have said that it's more difficult to file in federal court than it is in state court. And they have a point with that.
Right.
But it costs that employer money from day one when that individual files that claim with DWD or in court. That employer has to start paying attorney fees immediately. And so people were starting to bring up these charges against employers. And these employers, instead of for paying 2 or 3 years worth of attorney fees, they were writing these individuals checks just to go away. And we got rid of that.
Let me have
Wisconsin was 36th in the pay equity, and we moved up to 24th. Again, not great. We're not number one or number two.
The law
helped that, yes, because finally there were some teeth that you cannot discriminate against women. And this isn't based on women's choices. A man and woman going for the same job, a woman starts out at a lower rate.
Let me change topics.
Unless you're in the state or in government, then we get paid the same. And I think we should get paid the same no matter what we're doing.
Let me talk for a moment about another part of this equation when the war on women phrase is used. It's also referred to some changes in the state's abortion laws that were signed by the governor. And one of them on Friday, Planned Parenthood said that they're no longer going to provide medication-induced abortions because of uncertainty about what this new law means. It means you have to go see the same doctor three times. The doctor has to go kind of through a process to determine that the person's not being coerced in some way. The medical society says this is an intrusion on the patient-doctor relationship. Why are they wrong when they say that?
I think we need to protect the patient. And by making sure that that woman has an opportunity to meet individually with that doctor performing that abortion, apart from anyone else, apart from a parent that might be bringing that daughter in for that abortion, apart from an abusive boyfriend that might be coercing his girlfriend into having that abortion, giving that woman the opportunity to say no is protecting that woman. And I don't understand how that can be wrong in any way, shape, or form.
Now you do, in a very big way. Medical ethics has a very thorough legal, medical, ethical basis for informed consent. And part of that is giving the patient the autonomy to perhaps have an interpreter or a supporter or someone in the room when they communicate with a physician. That's just basic sound health care. And that the state is saying, no, you can't bring a supporter, a friend, a spouse into the room with you when you talk to a physician. The state is saying, is dictating that relationship. It's also putting the threat of a felony charge on the physician if he doesn't or she doesn't do things the way the state has said. It is the state trumping best practices in health care and criminalizing the physician for doing it. It's a very frightening overreach of government, and it's a very unnecessary overreach of government.
I'm going to give you the final word.
There was actually an incredible 911 call from individuals who called for a girl was being brought into an abortion clinic in Milwaukee, and that girl was pleading with people on the sidewalk saying, help me, I don't want to go in there. And yet those parents were bringing that daughter into the abortion clinic against her will. The police said, we can't do anything about that. Now that is wrong.
And it would be up to the physician to talk with that patient and make sure they weren't being coerced. And the state coming in based on, again, anecdotal 911 stuff. We have to do things based on evidence, not based on hearsay. And this is decades and decades full of informed consent, good best practices that the state is changing, and it's very, very frightening.
10 seconds.
Giving a woman an opportunity to say no on her own, that is best practices.
Representative Michelle Litjens, the Republican, Representative Sandy Pasch, the Democrat, thanks to both of you for being with us today. We appreciate it. Thank you very much. It's not generating as many headlines right now, but Wisconsin will elect a new U.S. Senator this year. Next, Republican Senate candidate Mark Newman on the state convention endorsement and the wild card in that race.
And later, are the gloves starting to come off in the Democratic primary for governor?
Upfront with Mike Boucher, brought to you by American Transmission Company and the Wisconsin Corn Growers Association.